let's go in order of the position papers. So we'll begin with the Aboriginal and Métis.
We represent the Aboriginal and Métis peoples. We are displeased with how we have been treated by the British, and we wish to be recognized as our own nation and have the right to govern ourselves. We are neutral on the unification of Upper and Lower Canada, but we wish the French culture, language, and religion be preserved as ours has failed to be preserved.
Bonjour. We are, on behalf of the supporters of Canada East, we too are also displeased with the British, and we would like to negotiate Confederation under a few conditions that our culture be protected and our language be maintained. Some examples of this are continuing French culture and traditions throughout the nation and providing schooling for French Canadians and keeping French as a national language. And finally, reserving half of the political seats to the French members of Canada East to increase diversity in the parliament. Thank you. Merci.
Leonard Tilly, and I'm from Atlantic Canada. I would first like to say that we, the Atlantic provinces of Canada, are not here to become a winner or a loser in this argument, but wish to become a part of a plan for a union that will forever grace the insides of the history books of our children. We offer a booming economy and access to the trade routes of the world, and believe that the proposed confederation is a very strong option for one united union separate from the British colonies. We would like to join.
We realize that a lot of you here today would like to separate from Britain and form a colony. We, as side Upper Canada, support this motion, and it is on these bases that we, side proposition, present the case that Canada should become a united nation. We define United Nation by separating from Britain, having our own government, not having to report to Britain, being able to make decisions for ourselves, separating from them almost entirely while still keeping trade routes with them. And we understand entirely that there are a number of you who feel that your rights have been violated and is a major reason why we are here today to negotiate them further.
So thank you to all. I'm Mary Ann Gabbery, and although I live in the West, I'm settled at the Red River Colony. I share a lot of the same values as the French Canadians. Mr. Papineau mentioned before, the French Canadians are open to negotiating a confederation, but we do have some conditions that we would like to maintain under the confederation. So Mr. Papineau mentioned, one of those propositions would be for French Canadians to have schooling that is specifically French Canadian and spoken in the French language. As well as churches, also within our religion. And some of the reasons for that would be to, first of all, maintain our cultural practices and pass on those to the coming generations in the new country, as well as to commemorate and honor the people who are sitting here today and who are working to make this confederation possible. So those are just some things that we wanted to mention, first of all, as well as making French a national language.
So basically, we just wanted to talk to the French about that there has to be freedom of choice for the people to go to either like French schools or English schools. And also, we wanted to clarify what exactly you meant by saying half the parliamentary seats are reserved for French Canadian speakers and speakers.
So, Ms. Speaker, first of all, we'd like to address the concern that the British stated about French schools and Catholic churches based on the French religion. Well, first of all, we wanted to make clear that it's not mandatory for all citizens of Canada to be attending these schools and attending these churches, but we wanted to provide the option for specific French Canadian citizens and parents that are looking for such an education. As for example, in certain areas of Canada at this point, you cannot find such education that supports the French. But we'd like, if we unite as one Canada, we would like to have this education spread throughout the entirety of this nation. And now, to address the second point about the seats in the House of Commons or the Parliament. First of all, we wanted to say that this was just a number that we chose based on the number of population and the amount of people that we have in this country that are French Canadian. But clearly, this number is negotiable depending on the
plans and implementations and conditions that you also provide us with and the things we can agree on today.
Seats are reserved for French Canadians. So what the number, I would respect that for you guys to have the number of seats that you deserve population-wise compared to the number of people from Britain or the number of people from Atlantic Canada, or sorry, Upper Canada, not Britain. Upper Canada and Atlantic Canada, and even the Aboriginals would be allowed to have people that they can vote for in their ridings. But I was wondering if you'd be looking for more than what your population would portray.
We would not like to be part of this new nation that is forming because we would like to be recognized as our own nation and have the right to govern ourselves in the way that's traditional to our people, which is not the British parliamentary system. So we will not be taking part in your country. We will be acting as our own country, and we may have relations with your country in the future on our own terms as an independent state from yours.
We're just asking for proportionally to our population as to negotiate amount of seats. Yeah.
The Aboriginals, real quick, skip back that topic, and their wish to form their own nation in their own country. I'd like to point out the fact that it'd be very beneficial to all of us if you could join forces with Canada, especially with America on the border. As a small nation, if you were to form your own country, you would most likely be invaded by the Americans. You wouldn't have any protection from the outside force. If you were to join with Canada, or even join Britain, either one. If you were doing Canada specifically, though, we could share land, we could share resources and power with you, and we could give you protection. Because if you leave us, chances are you're not going to be a big nation for very long. So I think it's in your best interest that you stay with us as a tribe.
Ms. Speaker, we would like to address that in saying that while we are willing to form an alliance with Canada, we would like to still be recognized as our own nation. And we would like to not be governed by the British. We would like the right to our own land, as we believe that part of this land is rightfully ours and that we shouldn't need to share it. We are welcoming alliance through trade, and we also welcome parts of the French community.
Ms. Speaker, so this is my point to the Aboriginal group. So this is from Mr. John A. McDonald. How do you think your Aboriginal groups will fend off the British once you have become a separate country from us? Or we right now have the relationship with the British, and if you do separate from us, you would no longer gain the benefits of being in a good par with British, with the British, and in fact of trade and economy.
Ms. Speaker, I would like to clarify the point that are they implying that if we become a separate nation, that they will attack us? That if we are not allied with them, we will have the need to defend ourselves?
Okay, wait, pause there. Stop talking. Okay, so if you do realize that, like, if you split up with us, then we're also in danger, not just you guys. And we can be more than the sum of our parts together.
Ms. Speaker, if I may bring up a bit of a point to this. So, I know that you're saying that as the sum of our parts, we will be greater, but why can we not be allied and still be joined, just not with us as part of your country, just being in an alliance with you? Because we would like to mostly have our own rights to govern ourselves and keep our own culture, but that doesn't mean that we can't be friends.
Migrating into proposing resolutions, this is an actual part of the debate where we're going to need to decide upon what our new future will look like. So we're going to really have to focus on figuring out who's going to be in our new Canada. Is there going to be a new Canada, and if so, what are the laws going to look like? So we're going to have each group, as we go around, really debating what the future now, and we're going to hopefully by the end have one concluded idea as to what this will look like. So if any groups want to make one final statement before we start talking about the future, we can.
Yeah,
Mr. Speaker, that you do have 2 million people in your community. While we as Canada are willing to give you a fair share of what would become our country of Canada, while we realize that we are 15 million and you are 2 million, while you could get a proportion, we think it would be fair to give you a proportionate amount to the number of your people, because we don't feel that you are, while we feel our rights should be equal, that means that for your 2 million, you should get the same amount as 2 million of our kind. So therefore, you're becoming kind of a small fish in a big pond. I mean, there are 15 million of us, and 2 million, and we just don't feel that we can fit all 15 million people in such a small piece of land as you requested.
Not exactly fair, because they were here before us and we did take over. So why is it not fair to give them what is rightfully theirs?
Can we agree with the speaker's point? What we are wondering, Mr. Speaker, is why are you giving us the land that we originally had back to us?
I'd just like to say that we've not yet heard back on the matter of whether we can have parliamentary seats proportionate to our population. And also, we would like French to be part of the national language, because we are wishing to preserve.
Ms. Speaker, we would also address what we would want coming from Confederation. We are isolated and we are small, but that doesn't mean we are here. We would like to pursue the goal of having equal representation in the Senate, as the French were saying before, as we believe we can offer a lot to this coming Canada.
So that we want parliamentary seats proportionate to our population, and I know the British haven't addressed this yet, but we would still like to put this on the table as a potential resolution, for we believe that the French community has a lot to contribute to the Canadian Parliament if we do unite, and we feel that we have a lot of benefits that we could bring to the table by having a proportionate number of seats to our population.
What was the second resolution? We would like to maintain our language and have the French be a secondary language, second national language in the Union. And we'd also like within that language to be access to schooling and religious practices.
One resolution that I guess we put forward is simply that if we are to unite as one nation and have many different moving parts that all have equal rights and representation and liberties, then all of those moving parts, including the French, including the other minority groups, possibly including the Aboriginals, if they decide to become part of this nation, then we must all contribute in this quest for independence. I understand that the goal is to separate from Britain. And that is not something that only the British Canadians want. And thusly, that is not something that only the British Canadians should be working to achieving. This is something we need to do together. And it will need everybody's resources and everybody's efforts and power.
Thank you.